Hello, I'm Dr. William Schlosser of Washington State University School of the Environment. This is my classroom.
Throughout our ecological journey into biomes, we have been talking about how their individual characteristics help to define commonality applied to the plants growing in each. That is to say, each biome presents unique characteristics giving rise to environmental consistency in plants and animals, availing themselves of the genetically attuned habitats. When we apply this consistency metric to specific biomes, we need to recognize the variation of environments and plants found within each. We investigate the North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands Biome to find flexible diversity originated through responsive biome characteristics. The myriad of abiotic variables within this biome form infinite complexities where precipitation, temperature and its timing, species diversity, and foundational soil characteristics combine in the creation of plant growth possibilities. This biome spans extensively across interior North America. It is not a homogeneous collection of ecosystems within this array, even though specific commonalities are found. North American biomes capture these continuous and disjunct land commonalities. By recognizing the plants surviving and thriving in each, we can identify distinctive ecosystems within each characteristic climate region. These commonalities are recognized by combined influences of soil structure with soil-based nutrients, topography, solar radiation, precipitation, weather systems, and climate. The interaction of these systems creates almost infinite combinations where plants grow. These are recognized as plant communities, made up from populations and their interactions with other populations. We are looking into the North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. The Palouse is a local variation of this biome. We can look beyond the limited extent of the Palouse to recognize how the biome extends. It reaches to the north into the Yukon Territory of Canada and into the state of Alaska. In disjunct patches, this biome is seen along the Rocky Mountain Range, the southwestern United States, and even into patches of Mexico. Commonalities only come through the results of how input variations produce consistent plant-growing environments. Look for these variations within each area holding this moniker. Conditions might be influenced by the substrate materials which limit water percolation past surface soils. This is what we witness in the southwestern two-thirds of eastern Washington, where flood basalts spread over the region from 17 to 11 million years ago. The basalt created a mostly impermeable layer where precipitation movement is held. Missoula floods, also known as the Spokane floods or the Brett's floods, name the cataclysmic floods that swept periodically across eastern Washington and down the Columbia River Gorge at the end of the last ice age. We know these events and how it changed the plant communities within this area to draw a distinct plant-growing corridor from the channeled scablands eastward to the Palouse. Those flood basalt substrate materials were overtopped by the loess soils blown in from glacial floodwater Lake Lewis to create nutrient-rich soils, where moisture is retained to hold the sustenance plants need. These thriving plant communities on these sites form the biome participants we recognize. These are part of the North America Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. Once this extensive prairie composed of mid-length perennial grasses such as bluebunch wheatgrass and Idaho fescue spread across these lands. Today, virtually all of the Palouse prairie is planted in agricultural crops. These landscapes have been influenced by anthropogenic activities. The native prairie is one of the most endangered ecosystems in the United States, as only a little over 1% of the original prairie still exists. This is representation of the native biome existing since the time of the glacial retreat that formed Lake Missoula, and its repeated flooding 15 to 13,000 years ago. This is a presentation of the original plant communities within the North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. Variation in plant participants introduced variability. These areas support native plant communities where bluebunch wheatgrass, Idaho fescue, and wheatgrasses dominate the sites. Shrubs fill the opportunistic niches to capture nutrients from the soils. Start to look closely at this soil layer. In places you see openings where nothing grows. We see some fractured soil with coarse pebbles and sandy soils. Parent materials include quartzite, feldspar, and eroded granite. Is that consistency? Hey, let's watch to find out. North of the Kramer Prairie, only about 5 miles, we come to Kamiak Butte. The Butte's physical site characteristics broaden plant communities' diversity. In the distance, agricultural fields dominate the anthropogenic influences. However, these lands are all within the same biome area. Agricultural crops cannot thrive on the Butte because of the quartzite soils below the lowest soil layers. This allows percolation of water past the reach of annual plants farmers want to grow here. Deep-rooted trees have a better chance to thrive on these sites. But their success may be limited based on the delivery of solar radiation and its timing. Plants enact a series of survival mechanisms to control when they photosynthesize, respirate, and grow. Natural resource ecology classes have visited Kamiak Butte to observe how energy is transferred from the Earth's powerhouse, the sun, to combine with soil-bound nutrients held by moist soil particles to be pulled through the plant roots, allowing plant growth. This process expresses biotic and abiotic interactions, showing the ability of plants to produce on each specific landscape. This is along the southern aspect of the Butte. Here, photosynthetically active radiation is presented early in the spring, creating a droughty stress on plants. Trees are sparse, mainly because of the limited shade produced by the trees currently growing here. With a little more shade, more woody vegetation might take root and grow. How would this scene look if the factor of time were extended? Think of this site 100 years from now. Would there be more successful trees growing on this site? Would that make more shade? What would be different? Talk about this situation happening within this biome. Walk northerly over the Butte. This is only 100 yards from the last scene. Douglas fir are growing thick. The sun reaches this site, but not with the high levels of solar radiation early in the season. Understory vegetation is well established. Native plant communities grow here. Think about the differences found on this north aspect site and compare it with the south aspect. They both receive virtually all the same inputs to growth. Their differences can mostly be levied on solar radiation amounts, delivered as a factor of their exposure-driven by-site aspect. These plants capitalize on the environment created here. Travel southward, only 50 miles to the Lewiston Grade, to find plant communities also influenced by anthropogenic forces. In this case, the introduction of cattle to graze these wintertime cattle-holding plots changed the surface soil productivity and the grass seeds growing here. Cattle were fed hay, which was grown in other areas. The seeds of those grasses passed through the cattle's digestive system and were left on these sites, loaded with nutrient-rich fertilizer. Sure, they sprouted and grew. These non-native grasses changed the plant populations on these sites. Want a confirmation? Look at the line drawn by the fence showing here. Original perennial native grassland plant communities look distinctively different than the non-native grass communities across the fence. This is an anthropogenic influence on these ecosystems. But they are still members of the North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. From the Lewiston Grade, we head down the Columbia River to walk up the slopes near the Tri-Cities. We see Artemisia sagebrush steppe growing within this same North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. These look very different from the other representative plant communities we've looked at so far. What commonalities do these sites share? They all experience similar climates, share water limitations for timing and temperature. Plant communities on all sites are competitive as they compete for sunlight and nutrients. Do you see the exposed soil surface? In places, there are exposed sandy and fractured rock exposures. This tells us water moves easily through these lands, extending beyond the reach of many plants. We travel southward to Nevada. The North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome still persists. Pinyon pine and juniper fill the niche of the trees growing in areas where photosynthetically active radiation facilitates their persistence. Shrub layers are filled with sagebrush and saltbrush plant communities. The populations are similar, albeit comprised of different species. We see trees, shrubs, and grasses. We also see patches of exposed soils with sandy texture and fractured parent materials. Plants compete for precipitation, nutrients, and limited space to live. Still in Nevada, we see the landscape has taken a slightly different profile. Flatlands in the foreground and some ridgeline background structures. Those shrubs are sagebrush, with some perennial grasses intermixed. Even on the hills, no trees are seen. The soils are dry, moisture is limiting, and plants are competing for these resources. Sunlight is not scarce, but plants need precipitation delivered during the growing season. We travel farther south and westerly into drier and warmer landscapes of the western interior shrublands and woodlands biome. Sagebrush species, combined with grasses, become dominant species in this landscape. These Utah plant communities are all competing for nutrients dissolved in precipitation at temperatures plants can capture. This is a repeating theme across this broad pitch. We head farther south and east into Colorado. Western juniper sprouts well here. Grasses and sagebrush fill the understory niche. They are competing for nutrients and water, but it seems space is not a limiting factor. There are still some open spaces at the soil level across these lands. Soils appear to be fractured and dry. Photosynthetically active radiation is still high, but that is not because of the aspect oriented to the rising summer sun. It is just the natural delivery of solar radiation on these sites. A little farther south into New Mexico, we see pinyon juniper woodlands filling this familiar niche. Sagebrush and bunch grasses sprout throughout these fractured soils where exposed soils are clearly evident. This site is lacking ample moisture to capture the nutrients these plants need. It seems these conditions persist. Soils can be the limiting factor of the plant structures as it is marginally wetted when the temperatures facilitate plant uptake. We will articulate the biomes of the areas we describe so our readers will understand what is shared. When doing this, present the name of the biome. Explain the generalities of where it is found. Include a map view of this biome to distinguish it from the neighboring biomes, with inclusions located in disjunct areas. Start by putting it into context. Describe the vegetative characteristics you find here. This is North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands Biome. We noted the presence of trees, shrubs, and grasses. Those trees are ponderosa pine, pinyon juniper woodlands, and western juniper. Sometimes Douglas fir and western larch are found. These biomes are not commonly represented by western red cedar, western hemlock, or spruce trees. Those species would indicate a shift to a different biome. We have seen sagebrush, saltbrush, and rabbitbrush overtopping bunch-type grasses. Under them all, we have watched the fractured and exposed soils across these lands. That is one of the consistent abiotic factors of this North American Western Interior Shrublands and Woodlands biome. These factors drive the delivery of precipitation at temperatures plants can capture. Those fractured soils are like the quartzite on Kamiak Butte. If 60% of precipitation is delivered as snow in the winter, then it will quickly flow past the reach of shallow roots when it warms. Only the early sprouting shrubs and grasses will be able to capitalize on this flush of nutrients and water. All other competitors will be at a disadvantage as they try to become robust participants. In each biome, you want to take note of the significant anthropogenic activities as you describe what is produced from these lands. That production statement may be hooked to what we as humans seek from these lands. Interestingly, it is often anthropogenic disruptions that we place the greatest value on. If you doubt that, then why do we describe the Palouse as the best wheat-producing lands in the world? You will be very efficient by recognizing how every biome is responsive to their geologic foundations and the movement of climatic patterns through these systems. recognize the native vegetation the biome is best known for, not its human-introduced agricultural crop only. Consider what historically made these lands stand out. Knowing those influences will shape how they are used now. These uses come in the form of agriculture, livestock husbandry, or human development potential. We use some of the most productive vegetative lands growing native trees, shrubs, and grasses for our most desired purposes. Oftentimes, that is not for agriculture or forestry, but to plant homes and towering skyscrapers. Our anthropogenic uses can change natural vegetation potentials. Domestic grazing on the grasslands of the Palouse and Camas prairies was transitory, because much of the areas were then rapidly converted to agriculture. However, the canyon lands of the Snake and Clearwater rivers, and their tributaries, with their much shallower soils, steep topography, and hotter, drier climate, were largely unsuitable for crop production. Those areas were consequently used for a much longer time period by grazing livestock. In many areas, they still are. Intense grazing and other disturbances have resulted in irreversible changes, with the native grasses largely replaced by annual grasses of the bromus genus and noxious weeds, particularly from the genus Centuria, yellow star thistle. The highly competitive plants of both genera evolved under similar climatic regimes in Eurasia and were introduced to the U.S. in the late 19th century. There are no natural predators of these invaders. They spread unchecked. Native vegetation, natural processes, and adaptive biome responses seek the balance established through equilibrium. Anthropogenic uses to introduce agriculture, livestock, establish hydroelectric energy plants, or windmills introduces a change to the equilibrium sought. Is that something we should consider as being a negative influence? Well, that can only be put into the category of values and personal perceptions. Humans are part of this environment, and our anthropogenic influences can be extremely disruptive or minor. We are most positively influential when we establish our responses through understanding biotic and abiotic needs in the biomes where we work. This is where we live, and recognize that none of the participants in this equilibrium balance are inconsequential.